Got your seatbelt on?
Yeah, we're ready to go in. Well, we just want to say good morning to everyone. And those that are joining us on the internet, we appreciate your attendance with us in spirit. Others that might be viewing from other places. Look, I want to look and start in Psalm 122. We looked at Psalm 121. Let me encourage you, when you read the Psalms like this or any portion of Scripture, take your time. No rush, no hurry. And just ask God, you know, to bring some thoughts, some of the words within the passage of Scripture, to bring it to your heart and not just to your head. And you might even try reading these out loud, because that's good to do. You don't have to worry about Satan, because he needs to hear a little more of the Word of God, that which we stand on. So you can read out loud, not all the time, but you can read out loud. But pay attention to what you're reading and notice, try to notice really what God is informing you and saying. Psalm 122, I was glad when they said unto me, let's go into the house of the Lord. Does that stir your heart? Hey, we're going to go to the house of the Lord. That ought to stir our hearts. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. Whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord. Good thing to do when we gather together. Verse 5. For there are set thrones of judgment and thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. Yes, and we can all say amen there. Thanks, Jack. Peace be within thy walls, and prosperity within thy palaces. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace within thee. Because of the house of the Lord, our God, I will seek thy good. Well, may the Lord add his blessing to his word. May he touch our hearts in numerous ways, and in ways of perhaps a special need in your life today. Well, let's go to 359 in our blue hymnal. 359. Jesus is Lord of all. If you would stand with me, those that are here, those at home, if you want to stand and sing too, feel free. 359. All my tomorrows, all my past, Jesus is Lord of all. I've quit my struggles, contentment at last, Jesus is Lord of all. O King of kings, Lord of lords, Jesus is Lord of all my compassions and all my life, Jesus is Lord of all. 359, second stanza. All of my conflicts, all my thoughts, Jesus is Lord of all. His love wins the battles I could not have thought. Jesus is Lord of all. O King of kings, Lord of lords, Jesus is Lord of all. Oh, all my impressions and all my life, Jesus is Lord of all. Let's sing the third stanza as well. All of my longings, all my dreams, Jesus is Lord of all of my failures, his power redeems, Jesus is Lord of all. O King of kings, Lord of lords, O Jesus is Lord of all my possessions and all my life, Jesus is Lord of all. I hope that is true in your life, that you've made him Lord over all. And Father, as we come before you this morning, how we lift our hearts as well as our voices in thanksgiving and praise, asking that this day, throughout the next hour or so, that multitude of blessings will flow, Father, down to us, your people. And may it be done by the carrier of the Holy Spirit, as he delivers the word of God, your words, to our hearts, to encourage us, to challenge us, and to just draw us closer to you. So have your will and way this day in our lives, and may this be a blessed time of worship in your presence. For it's in the name of Christ, your Son, my Savior, that I pray. Amen. You may be seated, and we'll have some announcements.
Okay. So first, just a reminder for those that want to come tonight, since it's cool today, I decided it'd be a good night for chili again, so I'll make chili for those that want to eat at 6 o'clock, and 6:45 for the evening service. I'm still in, of course, the book of Genesis. Wednesday night, we're still in Revelation, we usually have some type of light snacks on Wednesday night at 6:30, and then we do Bible study starting at 6:45. I'll just stand over here. It's too much reverb for me. So speaking of the sound, a person came and gave an estimate, and first let me tell you what's included in that. It would be included, you know, it's basically everything new wires, new speakers. He said, this microphone we have here is a really good one. That's not the issue we're having, is not with the microphone itself. But a new soundboard. The soundboard that we have, he said, even though it's only 3 years old, is antiquated already. And what he recommends is a digital soundboard. That would eliminate the problems with if somebody speaks more softly or loudly, it would automatically adjust, so you don't wouldn't have to worry about turning it up and turning it down. Now something he recommended that if somebody in the church could do, because it would, you know, he would have to charge extra for it, obviously, if they did it. But like he recommended that opening back there for the sound room be opened up so whoever's running the sound can actually hear what's in here. I've noticed when I go back in there, you can't hear as well. It just blocks the sound. So he said, if that's just opened up, just cut that wall out and open it up. He said that whoever's running the sound, they can actually hear what you all are hearing, because it gets you just can't tell. I just know, Nancy knows that, Mark Summers knows it, John Giles knows it, and I found it out too. So he said that would help that, so somebody who knows how to just cut out a wall. And he said, anyway, I can tell whoever wants to do that. So the cost is quite high, you know, everything goes up higher, but what I thought about is that if anybody wants to designate money towards it, then when the church has enough money, we can go ahead and do it. But it is $14,910, $2,000 of which of that is installation, and somebody's already donated money for that, so that $2,000 is covered. So I know it's a lot of money, but I know the man that did this, his business is called Sound Solutions, but he does the sound at Abba's house. So if you've ever been out there, you know what that's like there. And when I taught school at St. Peter's, I had him come in, and he did all the sound for all our programs. He installed all that. So he is really good, and he knows what he's talking about. When I directed musicals at the Memorial Auditorium or the Tivoli, I always had him come do the sound. So it's a lot of money, but I figured if it's the Lord's will, it'll happen. So it would be just really nice for that to be something that is not a problem, where you can hear Sunday school without popping and stuff, and then me too, so I'm not having to stand over here and not worry about the reverb. So anyway, be in prayer about that. I wanted to thank everyone, as Diane sent out for me, for praying for me as the biopsy came back negative. I think it's just normal for the doctor to always say, of course, that doesn't mean that I maybe don't have cancer, because they could have taken samples from where I don't have it. But just as a precaution, they'll do it again in 3 months on May 11th, and this time they'll take 12 core samples instead of 7. So, but as far as right now, it seems to be all good. So thank you for your prayers. I'm happy about that.
Well, good. Good news. Before I forget, because I have a tendency to do that, let's remember Frank in prayer. He's not able to come all the time, and he hasn't been coming lately because of his knee. I do believe he needs a knee replacement, and so he has a lot of pain, and sometimes he can't even hardly get around his apartment. But keep him in prayer as well. Let's go to 358. 358. Now we're going to stick into the 300s. We're going to go to 363 and maybe 367. We'll see what kind of time we have left. But I trust 358. I am thine, O Lord. On the first stanza. Oh, I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. Oh, but I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. And draw me nearer, near, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Oh, draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. On the second stanza. Oh, consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Oh, let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Oh, near, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Oh, draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. On the fourth stanza, all together. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow street. there are lights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with Thee. Oh, draw me nearer, near, blessed Lord, to the cross where Thou hast died. Oh, draw me nearer, nearer, near, blessed Lord, to Thy precious bleeding side. Now just back a few pages to 363. 363. Looking at the matter of love, more love to Thee, O Christ, more love to Thee. If there's one thing that we need to continually grow in, another thing to continually grow in is our love to the Lord. More love to Thee. First stanza.
To Thee, O Christ, more love to Thee. Hear Thou the prayer I make on blended knee. This is my earnest plea, more love, more Christ to Thee, more love to Thee, more love to Thee. On the third, then shall my latest breath whisper Thy praise. This be the parting cry my heart shall raise. This still my prayer shall be, more love, O Christ, to Thee, more love to Thee, more love to Thee.
Okay, I think we'll end there and have Jerry come, take some prayer requests, and have a time of prayer and Bible reading.
Good morning. We've come together to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May everything we do, everything we say, everything we think be to that end and to that aim. We want to honor and glorify Him in all that transpires here this morning. We have continuing remembering some of the ones that we've mentioned, just to give some updates and things. Of course, we're continuing to remember Mary. She's dealing now with another UTI, as well as with her eyes, so we need to remember that. My sister Brenda will be having carpal tunnel surgery February the 25th, so I would appreciate you remembering her. Ken mentioned the Slothauer, got it close to it, family. Bonnie has had a problem with the pacemaker that failed, and she needs to come here to the States, and she's a missionary in Trinidad. And she is doing that. Things have improved a little bit, not great, but improved a little bit. So we're thankful for that, and just pray for them as they make this transition. Then Wednesday night was mentioned Annabelle Bachmann was having some kind of procedure and would let us know more about it as they found out the results. So let's pray for her physical needs. Michael Van is to be having his surgery this week for the melanoma, and they're to go in, cut out, and then check to see that they got it all. If they need to go back, then they will. Jackie sent us a little message this morning that she's taking care of her, Brian and Cooper this weekend and is not able to be here, so she wanted to, us to know this. We want everyone to continue praying for Scott in the healing of his leg from the pressure sore. He went to the doctor this week, and the doctor felt that the sore was looking better, especially near his ankle, and the doctor doesn't feel like the pump that they were talking about, which was going to be quite expensive, would be any more help at this particular time. Excuse me. If everything continues to heal, then at his next appointment, they will begin the skin grafts, and we're hoping that, and praying that that will take place. And this is the first week that they haven't had to cut even more skin away, so that's sounding good. They do ask us to remember them in prayer. And then we've had several of our members that experienced the death of loved ones in their families, and I just want to bring this to your attention to have you to pray for them. The Bosser family, this is Mark's neighbor and the loss of a father. The Scoggins family and the death of Wally. The Payne family, the death of Rich. This was a tragic situation where a tree fell and killed him, and his son was out there and saw it all. So it's a difficult time for him, Josh. And then Wanda's best friend, Jamie, Blevins, in her passing. So we need to remember that. And then Nancy got word just this morning that her brother, Alan, is in the hospital with COVID, and need to remember him. Another one that's dealing with what's going on around now. And then Karen has asked us to remember a friend of hers, Sandy, and prayer for her cancer, and she had the surgery, but now then they're waiting for the results of that. So continue to remember that. Anything else that? Okay, so Annabelle's sugar level and cholesterol is up, and so that's what the tests were about, and so they need to work on that, and doing that with the treating right now with diet. Right. Okay. All right. And then on a lighter note, just let you know about this. Was it yesterday? Yesterday, Deanna and a teammate of hers, Cameron, was in a debating contest, and they won the state college debate contest. And so we're very proud of her. They were competing with several colleges, and they won 3 out of 3 in the finals. So that's very good. So maybe they'll be in a little bit later, and we can congratulate her. So that would be good. All right. Our scripture reading this morning. You know, these are days of fearfulness, and a lot of people just find themselves not knowing what to do and what to think. But what we need to do is turn to the truth of God's Word and listen to what God tells us. This is what He says in His Word. I will both lay me down in peace and sleep, for Thou, Lord, only makest me dwell in safety. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night. He shall cover thee with feathers, and under his wings thou shalt trust. Even as hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the covert of thy wings. The darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. He that spareth not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Ye are Christ, and Christ is God's. I will trust and not be afraid. Let us pray. Our Father, what a privilege and what a joy it is to come before you, to come to your throne of grace, to bring these requests before you. And you know the need. Father, you are perfectly aware of every situation. You know the families that are hurting because of the loss of loved ones. And you know the families that are concerned because of surgeries that they've just had, and concerned because of anticipation of surgeries. But Father, you are the one that supplies, and we look to you and bring these before you and just trust in you to do that which would honor and glorify you and good and profit for those that are involved. Be with us as we open your word today. May your Holy Spirit speak to us, and may we honor and glorify you. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Men will come forward. We'll receive our morning offering.
Thank you, Mary. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. While you're turning, I didn't mention this earlier, but I do appreciate those of you that have been praying for one of my dogs that's not well. I know I mentioned that that doesn't sound strange to some people, but if you have a pet that is like part of your family, then you understand that request. But the initial cytology came back saying that it was not cancer, that it was just inflammation. And then they did the CT scan, and the radiologist said, well, looks like could be the thyroid gland or the salivary gland. The salivary gland would coincide with inflammation as opposed to the thyroid gland, which would be cancer. But they did another biopsy, and still waiting for that because the treatment will be different. Obviously, if it is thyroid cancer, the prognosis is not good for Buddy. Buddy's normal healthy weight is 85. He's down to 62 now, so significant weight loss. But I'm having to feed him. I got cans of puppy food, you know, because he can't swallow. This has caused it's pressing against, where the trachea and the esophagus are, so it makes it difficult for him to swallow. So it's been easier for him to eat that. So I'm doing whatever I can. But for those of you who understand the love of pets, I do appreciate your prayers. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, let's open with prayer. Heavenly Father, we're thankful again today that we have more time that we can spend in your word. We thank you for the Sunday school lesson this morning, reminding us of the grace that is yours for us, that you want us to grow in. Father, as we look at your word this morning, as you inspired Paul to write, that you would help us to understand it, but most of all, help us to apply it, especially in these last days in which we're living. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So we're picking up in verse 9, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9. As you know, we're just going verse by verse through the Bible, so I just think it's interesting that verse 9 is going to be about love, and so today's Valentine's Day, so that is not anything planned. It's not a topical message, but it's just where we are starting right now. So 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9, Paul says, but as touching, the word touching, we would probably use the word concerning. He says, but as concerning brotherly love, ye need not that I write to you. This is something that he didn't have to tell them about. They had this. Now, brotherly love is two words in the English. In the Greek, it's one. Philadelphios is the actual word in the Greek, so that's brotherly love. As you know, the city Philadelphia is named from that. So, and not only, of course, the one in Pennsylvania, but the original one in modern-day Turkey, which was one of the seven churches in the book of Revelation that letter was written to. So is concerning that, he said, I don't need to write to you. But he goes on, for ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another. But the love word here is agape. Now, so with just reading the English, you might not know that. You might think, well, he's talking about the same thing. He doesn't need to write to them about the brotherly love. That's, you know, being fond of each other, that kind of bond that we have, not just meaning your family, but the spiritual family that we have. But agape is, and we're not doing 1 Corinthians 13 this morning, but that's traditionally called the love chapter, where Paul's inspired to there define love. And he spends a lot of time saying what love isn't. He says more things about love is not. Then he says what love is. And so the big thing that I think about agape love is that it's unconditional. It's the kind of love that God has for us. If God only loved us if we were good, you see where that would leave us, right? So it's unconditional. And that is not actually something that I believe we can do on our own, because self gets in the way, and when self is there, we just have the tendency in our human nature that we were born with, even though we're saved now, that sin nature is very much still alive, and with that sin nature, the tendency is to, for instance, be selfish, where in 1 Corinthians 13, love is not selfish. But it is in our tendency. It's the kind of thing where we put conditions on love and say, well, I love you if you do this. I love you if you do that. Or I love you if you don't do this, and I love you if you don't do that. But this is unconditional. And there's so many scriptures about we're to forgive one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven us. So that's all entailed in this love. Now, if we were to literally speak about Valentine's Day, it is a different word for love altogether. In the Greek, there's three words for love. In the Hebrew, there's 14. But, you know, we just have the one. We use it loosely. I think about food that we might like. For instance, I like spaghetti, so I might say, I love spaghetti. Well, we understand in the context of that how a person might love a certain kind of food. But in the Greek, there are those specific words. And in a marriage, that is a special love unique to marriage. So here, he first mentions this brotherly love, phileo, and then agape. So he says, you're taught of God. You're taught from God. We all, as believers, are taught, that is, if we get in the Word of God and be taught, that we need to have this unconditional agape love for each other. Now he continues in verse 10, and he says, indeed ye do it toward all the brethren which are in all Macedonia. He was saying, you know, he's complimenting them and how much they love each other. Just as I would not be just making up the phrase to say, I love to see the love that's in this church and the love that you show to each other. Because that's not in every church. Paul didn't say this to every church he wrote to. And it's certainly in less churches today, as we just reviewed that in the Bible study when we were going through the seven churches. And one of the aspects of them is different periods of time in the church age. And we're in the Laodicean church age. And most churches today fit that description. It's just a social gathering where people come together to be entertained. Now, again, I always say there's nothing wrong with having a nice choir and having nice special music. We all enjoy that. And we appreciate those who are willing to share their talents God gave in that way. But that isn't why we come. We don't come to hear the choir sing a special or do a cantata. We don't come to hear specifically that, and it's not entertainment. I remember growing up as a child, and I remember certain, they'd have guest speakers, they called them evangelists, and they would come and preach. And because I hadn't grown in the Word, I didn't know, so I knew nothing about the content of the Word. I just thought, wow, listen to them preach. I mean, some of them would jump. You've seen preachers do that. Nothing wrong with jumping, but it's not really necessary with the content. I mean, a person could do all that jumping and have all that animation and all that drama and be devoid of anything from the Word, any truth, any scripture, any spiritual food. So I used to think, and I'm sure a lot of people still do today, especially in the age we're living, that they think is good preaching. Somebody that is dramatic. But anyway, getting back to the scripture. So their love is mentioned here because he said the news of how you're loving in that whole region of Macedonia, which was the northern part of Greece. But we beseech you, he says, brethren, that ye indeed increase more and more. So yes, he's saying you're loving one another, that's great, but don't stop where you are. It needs to increase. Keep that up. And I think it was a recent lesson that Mark Summers gave when he was filling in for Jerry about what in the Hebrew, what is entailed in love is giving. All right, let's look at verse 11. This is interesting as it reads in the King James. And it says, that ye study to be quiet. Well, that's an interesting phrase, right? The word study here from the Greek means to have ambition, for it to be a desire, something to work at. Which actually, when you think about the word study, and those of you still in school know what study means, I always thought it would be really nice. I've heard about people that thought you could study for a test by putting the material under your pillow at night and as you slept, it would just float somehow into your brain. Wouldn't that be nice? We could learn that way. Just, you know, even the Bible, just take it, put it under a pillow at night, and have it float into our brain. But it doesn't work that way. Studying is something you have to work at. You have to spend time at. You have to pay attention. It has to be a desire. I think a lot of kids growing up don't realize when their parents want them to learn, they don't quite sometimes always understand why it's important. Why it's important. But it makes a difference. It makes a difference in life. All right, so that's in the word study. And this says to be quiet. Well, the word quiet here has to do with peace. Peace is something we have to work at. That's why the phrase, as Paul uses in Romans 12, you know, like peacemaker. Peace has to be made. It just doesn't happen. You have to work at it. It has to be an ambition. And this goes along with the rest of the verse because he says, and to do your own business. Now, that's not contrary to the other scriptures where he said, you know, fulfill one another's burdens. You know, we should be there willing to help when help is needed. But we should have enough of our own. You know, you think about the word business. If you take the first part of the word, change the I to a Y, it's busy. Busyness. That's what the word is. We just say it quick and say business. Busyness. We get, there's things we have to do. We're busy in our own, in our busyness. But there's enough of that for ourselves that we don't need really to have time to get into other people's busyness. So that all is entailed here in study to be quiet. To do your own business and to work with your own hands as we commanded you. Now, there's a lot of scriptures Paul talked about this. Now, again, I always shy away from speaking about politics in the pulpit, but it's difficult when things come to welfare, you know, and there's been people propose, well, let's do welfare reform. And what's always hard is because there are people that get on welfare that really can work, but they're not. So you say, okay, well, we'll eliminate these people, but it's often the children then that suffer. So it's hard. I remember visiting the Dominican Republic, which is the island of Hispaniola, you know, because half of the island is Dominican Republic and the other island is Haiti. Totally different countries. Haiti's a third world country, if you've ever visited there. And Dominican Republic does not have welfare. And I remember on a tour, people were saying, no welfare. What about people that can't work? And they said, well, we believe everybody can do something. Even if they're crippled in a wheelchair, everybody can do something. So that was their way of doing it. So I'm not promoting anything or trying to say, but that was their way. And, you know, I thought about it because there's no, you know, we talk about boundaries of countries. There's no, like, wall that keeps people from. So, I mean, I really don't think, you know, the Haitis go over to the Dominican Republic because they're not going to get anything from there. So, the Haitians, excuse me. But anyway, Paul said that he does not work, does not eat. So, this is all entailed in this. But verse 12, he said, why does he say all that? That you may walk honestly toward those that are without. So it's not just, you know, we're walking worthy of the vocation, or we should walk, as Ephesians 4 says, of the vocation with which we've been called. That is, as believers, there's a certain kind of life that we should be living, the word walk implying that. But it's not just for that reason. But there's others that see us, and so those that are without. And then he says here that ye may, oh, by the way, the word honestly can be translated properly. Walk properly. That ye may walk properly toward those that are without. That ye may have lack of nothing. So that you don't have the lack of things if you're doing what verse 11 says. Instead of getting busy about other people's business, we need to make sure we're doing what we needed to do so we're not lacking the things that we need. Now he gets to another subject in verse 13, and this is a phrase that Paul uses a lot. All of us have heard it. I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren. So this is something, brethren, of course, old word for brothers, and so not to get off on the subject, but there's some people, there have been books written now, a translation of the Bible, and so they would say here, they change brethren to children or brothers and sisters somehow to make sure that there's no, you know, because they say, well, it looks like brothers, that's excluding females. So anyway, I won't get off on all that. But this is, so brothers mean believers. He wants us to know this, to not be ignorant of it. And the word ignorant usually is used in a derogatory sense, so a lot of people use it that way, but it just means to not know. And we all, there's lots of things that we all don't know. I mean, different, maybe whatever your field of study that you studied, and you know more about that than other things. And we can't know everything. But there's, so that's not what ignorant implies, but it's just that there's certain things that we want to make sure we know. And what he's about to talk about here is one of those things. All right. I would not to have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep. Now, you already know that in the Bible, it's not talking about when it says asleep here, like when we go to bed at night and sleep. Or if you have insomnia, you just go to bed at night. So anyway. But it's not talking about that. The word is, we know, used throughout the scripture. It often, not always, but often refers to death. And that's what it does here. For those who have died. So he's going to talk about those who have died. And then he says, that ye sorrow not. And that doesn't, there's not a period there. There's more. It's not that when our loved ones die, we don't have sorrow. There's something wrong if you don't. But it doesn't have to be, as we read the rest of the verse, it doesn't have to be the same kind of sorrow as it could be for others. It says, even as others who have no hope. Now, it's true that a lot of Christians don't know what the hope is, but they actually still have the hope. It's still there. It doesn't go away just because I don't know what it is. But this is not the hope that we get to go to heaven. As believers, we know we will be in heaven. We know the hope has to do with that when we stand there at the judgment seat, that we hear, well done. That's the hope. But lost people don't have that hope. Right? They don't have it. So think about, if you're sorrowing, it's a different kind of sorrow for those who don't have that hope. All right, so he says, you don't have to sorrow in the same way, in other words. Verse 14, he explains, for if we, that's, he's including himself, or we as believers, believe that Jesus died and rose again, and this is one in the Greek, it has moods, and so we know that Jesus did die and rise again. whether a person believes that or not doesn't change the fact that it happened. And believers believe this. So we might say that it means the idea since. Since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so those also who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. So first of all, he's wanting to make sure we know that those who have already died, believers that have already died, they're not going to be left out. They won't be left out. In fact, to get to the details, we'll get ahead of ourselves here, but we know the dead in Christ rise first, and then we which are alive and remain. But those have died before us. They're already there in heaven. Their souls are there in heaven. Their bodies are wherever they were left here on the earth. They will be put back together. If we're alive when the rapture happens, we just get new bodies like that. But their soul gets put back in their body. So this idea, will God bring with him? So, those souls are there, and they're brought and put back. Of course, it's not the same old body that we had here, but there'll be new bodies for them as well. Verse 15, "For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not," and in the King James the word "prevent," I'll talk about that, "shall not prevent them which are asleep." Now the modern word, this is where I always say you can't, in studying the Bible, say, okay, what does that mean, prevent? So you get out a dictionary and look up the word prevent. It will be the wrong definition. Okay? And some people say, well, that's why I like different translations of the Bible. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with different translations. I'm not one of those who insists that you can only use the King James Version. I prefer to use it, but I'm not one that says that. Because they say, well, God authorized that translation, whatever that's supposed to mean, somehow that God guided it. It was seven, the heads of that committee were seven Puritans and seven Anglicans, so I don't know, but anyway. And I always think about, what are people that don't speak English? This is just an English translation of the Greek and Hebrew. A lot of people in the world don't speak the same language we do, so even if it's Old English or New English, they, you know, so. Anyway, I'm getting off on that. But so the word prevent, okay, so you look at, break it down as the way it looks literally, and you see the first part is pre, which means before, right? And then you see the second part of the word vent. Now, we have a lot of words like advent, event. An event is a happening. Pre means happening before. So that's what it means. Just like another example, when you read in the parable of the talents, parable of the talents, and you see that it says he gave to each one according to their several ability. That's the word used in the Old English, several. And we use several as meaning lots or many. But the old word, several, you take the first part of the word sever, which means to separate, to sever. Several ability means separate ability, individual ability. So that's another example of a word that has changed meanings. But okay, so this happens before. So we would use the word precede. Happens before. So he's just simply saying here, those which are alive and remain to the coming of the Lord shall not precede, that is, come before those who are asleep. Now, as we see in the scripture, God has order. There's no chaos with God. There's order. And although I speak about, in fact, hold your place here a moment and go to 1 Corinthians 15 for a moment. Just back up a little bit, but hold your place in Thessalonians. 1 Corinthians 15. And we'll look at verse 51. 1 Corinthians 15, 51. I think most of you have this memorized, but 1 Corinthians 15, verse 51. Paul's inspired here when he writes, "Behold," it's the old word, say, "look." In other words, see this. Understand this. "I show you a mystery." Mystery is something that was hidden and now is being revealed. "I show you a mystery. We," referring to believers, "shall not all sleep." And the word "sleep" is used the same here in Corinthians as it is in Thessalonians. "Will not all die." By the way, people that want to take Hebrews 9:27, it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. I don't know what, It's not a contradiction of verse 51. It's an exception. It's a mystery being revealed. If we're alive when the rapture happens, we won't see death. All right. So, we won't all die, but we, that is believers, shall all be changed. Now, I know there's people that teach different things out there, and you can pick up books and read them, and just be careful what you read. Make sure it goes along with the scripture. But it says we'll all be changed. Now, it doesn't mean everybody in the whole world. Paul's including himself here. He doesn't mean all of creation is changed, but he's talking about all believers. Now, verse 52, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, and that's what I wanted to see here based on what we're looking at Thessalonians. In a moment, okay, you know, we use words in this phrase. You say, you've heard somebody say, you might ask your parents something. Maybe you go to your mom and say, Mom, can I have something? Just a moment, right? It's a phrase, just a moment, and you stand there looking at your watch, just a moment. Right? It's been a minute, Mom. It's an expression. It's doesn't have to mean literal. Now, I'm a literalist. I might have told you the story before. My mom said she always wanted me to, like, peel potatoes before the supper. She said, just peel some. And I said, well, how many? Just peel some. Well, some. So I was an exact, I needed to know the number. Well, of course, I understand why she couldn't tell me a number. Potatoes aren't all the same size. And with a family of eight, if you're going to have enough potatoes for eight people, you have, it's the amount that, you know, but she just peeled some. So anyway, that was difficult for me. I had to have a number. So I'm a literalist. And so, some, you know, I always think moment, minute. It doesn't mean minute here because he describes it as in a twinkling of an eye. Now, and I've heard people debate about, is a twinkle faster than a bat, I don't, you know, the bat of the eye. The expression is how fast your eye blinks. Our eyes are constantly blinking, right? It happens so fast. You can be driving on the road, your blink happens so fast, it doesn't obstruct you from being able to see. But it's God's mechanism to keep our eyes moist, right? If your eyes quit, people that have glaucoma, their eyes aren't blinking enough, and so it's difficult. All right, so God's designed us for the eyes to do that. It's fast. But the idea is it's really quick. So you can go ahead and leave Corinthians now, come back to 1 Thessalonians. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. But here he says, the dead in Christ shall rise first. All right, so if they'll not precede us or come before, but it's in order. He's giving us the order, and yet, in as far as we understand, it would be instantaneous to us. It's not like, oh, well, it's their turn first, and then they'll get up there, and then they will go. It's in a twinkling of an eye, just like that. I always think about at the Olympics now, they use those lasers that go across, and they're counting by the hundredths of a second. You divide a second into hundredths. That's amazing, 100 times. And so they could win the race by 0.01, a hundredth of a second. And they just know whoever touched that laser first. I remember some of you may know from Daytona Heights, Earl and Francis Brown, and when I first came to Chattanooga, I stayed with them in their house up in Stonehenge, and they had a guest bedroom in the basement, so I was down there. I mean, it's a finished basement, but it's down there, and they said no, they had a security system, and they was telling me about the security system, and it had lasers, so if somebody came in, you know, it would be detected. So one night I had to go to the bathroom, and the bathroom, I had to come out of the bedroom door and go to the next room, which was the bathroom. But I didn't know if I would trip the laser, so I was crawling down on the ground. I didn't want to set off their alarm system while I went to the bathroom. But anyway, the laser technology, so it can be that fast, and you know who wins, because to our eyes and what we can see in real time, it looks like it's the same. But God is just saying that things are in order. But yet to us, it'll seem instantaneous. All right, verse 16, 1 Thessalonians 4:16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. Now, I often thought, well, with a shout. Do you remember when in Revelation 4:1, which represents the rapture for us, as John sees an opening, he's at a door opened, he sees an aperture, whatever you want to call it, he sees an opening, and he heard a voice say, come up hither. That's the King James. In modern English, we'd say, come up here. And he went. He was changed. The instant changing that happened had to happen for him to be up there. But he went. So I wonder if it's something like that. Come up here. And those that hear his sheep hear his voice, right? So with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, so the actual voice of the archangel. You can read about more in Revelation 12. And with the trump of God. Trump is the old English word for trumpet. Now, I don't know how many people get really confused, but they see the word trumpet here, and in the book of Revelation, it has seven trumpets. So they somehow have concluded that this is one of those seven trumpets. No, it can't be. It can't be one of those. It's not at all. In fact, when you go back to the Old Testament and look at the different things the trumpet was used for, it wasn't all for the same thing. Right? Just like we have alarm systems for certain things. Not all cities have it, but some have. If there's a tornado warning, there'll be a siren that sounds. It's a certain sound. If you hear that, you know, maybe turn on your radio, whatever you have, or turn on, usually if you have your TVs on, and say, this is, you know how you've always heard, I think all of us heard, this is a test of the emergency broadcast system. This is only a test. But I once was driving in Alabama when it said, this is not a test. Ooh. The sky looked pretty dark. A tornado has been spotted and moving in certain directions. I mean, that's a different thing. This is not. So we have different alarms, right? But you know the sound that comes across your TV or your radio when that comes, so there's all different kind of sounds. I know that's irritating kind of sound, but it's purposely that way so that you hear it. So in Israel, if they're people in the watchtowers, if they saw danger coming, the trumpets would sound the alarm. Now, that's not the same alarm as when they were going to have a meeting for the people to gather together. That's this kind of trumpet. This is a gathering. We're all, as believers, the body of Christ is gathered together. We're going to gather with him in the air. So it's a different sound. And, you know, I always think about, as I was in Boy Scouts, growing up, and people that are in the military, they have certain counts. And I played trumpet through school, so I knew about the trumpet. And the beagle is the same thing without the valves. If you know a trumpet, same as a cornet, has three valves on it. And a bugle doesn't have any valves. You do all of the changes of the notes with your lips, your embouchure. Anyway, so I played in Boy Scouts. I played the thing. So you wouldn't play, when it's time to go to bed at night, you wouldn't play da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That would be the wrong sound, right? So my point is, this trumpet, the trumpets in Book of Revelation are, John is getting more details of what will happen in the last half of the tribulation. This is a trumpet that's gathering us together. The trumpet shall sound. It says it's the trump of God. It's his trumpet. And it says, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Now, just like any part of the word, you can't take a phrase out. Think about it for a minute, because this is apparently what some people do. Take out the phrase, in Christ. If we just read it, the dead shall rise first. It's not all the dead that are going to rise. If we're not in Christ, and all believers are in Christ, if we're not in Christ, we will not rise. This is not, I mean, for those that are dead already, but this are those that are in Christ.
The rapture will be those that are in Christ. Now, there are other believers. For instance, you got the Old Testament saints. They believed in God. They were looking for the Messiah to come. Then you got the tribulation saints, those that believe in the tribulation. They're believers, but they're not in the body of Christ. They're not in Christ. That's specific to when the Holy Spirit came down at Pentecost, 50 days after the resurrection, and until the rapture, that is the fullness of the Gentiles. That's why when Paul says, till the fullness of the Gentiles be come in, when the body of Christ is complete, those that are in Christ, that's the church, that's the body of Christ. I'm not talking about the bride that gets revealed at the judgment seat, right, out of the body. But the Old Testament saints and the tribulation saints, they're not counted in the church. They'll be counted with Israel. So we have to keep that straight in the scripture, or people, again, because they're not rightly dividing the word, can get false teaching. So we see the phrase in Christ. It's not all the dead that are raised here. If you read Revelation 20, eventually all the dead. It says, and the rest of the dead were raised. But they're those who never believed. Now, you got tribulation saints and Old Testament saints, they're raised too. It's all part of what we call the first resurrection. But we see that the second resurrection is the raising of all those who never believed, and they're judged and cast into the lake of fire. This is those who are in Christ. They rise first. Verse 17. Now, keep in mind, I already pointed out in verse 14, it says, those who sleep in Jesus, again, that's Jesus Christ, will God bring with him. So we already saw the way, okay, so what does it mean if the dead in Christ rise first and God brings with him? It's because their souls are of our loved ones that are already there. Their souls are there. Their bodies are here. You see what's happening? Oh, yeah, keep shouting. Verse 17. Then we, which are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. All right, let's look at the word cloud up. Caught up. All right, the phrase caught up. The time goes so fast. Okay, so I'll try to wrap this up. Caught up is two words translated from one Greek word, harpazo. Only occurs four times in the Greek. And I know there's people that say, well, I don't believe in the rapture because I can't find the word in the Bible. Now, if you have a newer Bible, a newer translation, it might translate it rapture. The rapture means the catching up. That's what it means. So for people that say, well, I don't see the word rapture in the Bible, so I don't believe in the rapture. That's absurd, because it's the meaning of the word caught up. All right, raptured, it's caught up. All right, so they which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. All right, that's the dead in Christ. So we're caught up together with them. Their bodies are coming up to be joined together with their souls, and they get new bodies. We're going to see, or we just saw in 1 Corinthians 15, we get the new bodies. We get changed. We get a glorified body. But Paul here is talking about how we're caught up together with them in the clouds. For what purpose? To meet the Lord in the air. And this word for air here is talking about it's a thick air. It's in our atmosphere. And the reason I mention that is because it's not talking about 7 years later at the end of the tribulation when Christ comes all the way to the ground and his feet land on the Mount of Olives. This is just in the air where the clouds are. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Now, going back to, as we wrap this up, in verse 13, that when we lose a loved one, we don't have to sorrow the same way as those who don't have the hope. Again, I said, I don't think Paul's getting into the fact here that some don't know what the hope is. But lost people don't have the hope. They can't hope to hear, "Well done, well done, thou good and faithful servant," because they're not a servant, and they won't be there to hear anything. But so the sorrow here, then notice verse 18. Wherefore, that's a connecting word, comfort one another with these words. The word comfort means encourage. So, yes, it's hard when we lose loved ones. And all of us have done that. But it's comforting to know that we will be together again. Because he's coming like he promised. Let's close in prayer. Father, tonight, thank you again, this morning, thank you again that we could be reminded of these scriptures. I know that it's still hard when we lose a loved one, and there's still sorrow. And that never completely ever goes away. And sometimes it's a hurt. It's like an empty feeling in our chest, like something's missing. And that never completely goes away, but I'm thankful that as your children, you want us to make sure that we know that because we're yours, because we're in Christ, we will be together again when he comes for us. So, Father, we thank you for reminding us of this morning and encouraging our hearts. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, let's go to 366. Light of the Word and light of grace and truth. We should also surrender every day. Every day ought to be a day of surrender. If you would stand with me. 366. All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily.
Thank you, Ken and Mary. Let's close in prayer. Father, again today, we're thankful that we could come together and worship and praise you for all that you've done. Help us to focus in our Christian lives on the things we're thankful for. But we're thankful that you told us to make our requests known to you, not because you don't already know them all, but because you want us to come ask. So, Father, all these we've been praying for, we continue to lift up. And we just pray that your will would be done. As we go our separate ways, help us to be faithful ambassadors that when others see us or hear us, they'll know who we represent. For we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.